I announced last Wednesday, we're going through the seven capital sins in our seven Wednesday sermons. And the order that I'm following is the one in this book, which is a moral theology book, because you'll find different order. There's no right or wrong order of the seven capital sins. So you may have memorized them in a different order that I cover them. Pride is usually always ranked first, because it is the source, in one sense, of every sin. But this book gives as the second of the seven capital sins covetousness. Covetousness, or avarice, which is the same thing. Covetousness is the inordinate love of temporal things, usually of riches. It will be inordinate if one is not guided by a reasonable end in view, such as suitable but not exaggerated provision for one's family, the future, or others, or if one is too solicitous in acquiring wealth to the neglect of one's duties, or too parsimonious in dispensing. Covetousness is an equal sin in itself, since riches are indifferent things, but it will become a grievous sin if it lead to any other grievous sin, such as injustice or uncharity, or if the means employed are grievously sinful. Here's a quote from St. Thomas Aquinas. According to St. Paul in his first epistle to Timothy, chapter 6, this vice is a source of all evils. For by riches, man acquires the means of committing any sin whatever, and of satisfying his desire for every sin. Since money helps one to obtain all manner of temporal goods. And according to Ecclesiastes, all things obey money. That is, so that in this sense, desire for riches is the root of all sins. Other commentators explain St. Paul's quote by saying that covetousness acts as a motive or spur to the commission of all kinds of sins, for there is nothing a man will not do, as experience proves, whose master passion is the desire of wealth. His vice is insatiable and cruel. Thus St. Ambrose said, the more avarice has got, the more it believes itself to be indigent. It envies all and is poor in its own eyes. Needy in the midst of riches, it thinks little of its abundance. How sad that someone would be blinded. And covetousness does just that. It blinds a person. You might remember the story, true story, that is found in the life of St. Anthony, that there was a man who was very covetous. And St. Anthony was trying to convert him to no avail. And one day he was giving a sermon, and he was enlightened to the fact that this man had just died. And in the course of the sermon, he talked about how our Lord said that where a man's treasure is, there also will his heart be. And he said, so-and-so has just died, and you can go to this treasure chest and open it, and there you will find his heart. And it literally was so. So by this miracle, God showing that his whole life revolved around money. And what a sad, sad state to be in. Now the author goes on to talk about the different vices that result from covetousness. The results which this vice ordinarily and easily produces are, number one, hardness of heart towards the poor, whether in not giving alms to those in need or harshly exacting payment or debts. Number two, disquietude concerning the possible loss of wealth or impossibility of getting it. So a person that has this vice is just never at peace. He's always worried. And our Lord talked about that, and he said that a rich man has all this wealth, and he says, well, I will build more barns so I can store all my food, all my grain, etc. And then our Lord concludes by saying, thou fool, this night do they require thy soul of thee. In other words, that man is going to die that night. So there's this disquietude, this worry that they might be stolen from me, they might be taken. And it's not just a normal worry, it's an excessive worry, and it brings the disquietude apart. And thirdly, it results in deceit encompassing wealth, commercial dishonesty, overreaching others, in trade by unjust methods and violation of inconvenient contracts. The remedies against this vice are to consider how fleeting are the riches of this world, how precarious is fortune, how contemptible the world in comparison with heaven. Second, to meditate on the poverty of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Third, to oppose all tendency to avarice by being generous and merciful in almsgiving. And fourth, to look upon all gifts of fortune or nature as a loan for use to the greater glory of God. And it mentions almsgiving in here, and that's something that in the liturgy is brought out during the season of Lent. In fact, we have a section in the Divine Office for the weekdays of Lent that talks about giving alms. And we recall that the Archangel Raphael said to Tobias that alms wipes out the punishment due to sin more than anything else, even more than our prayers, etc. That it's very pleasing to God for atonement for past sins. And finally, the virtue, contrary to covetousness, is liberality, which inclines one to expend money or any of one's possessions reasonably, moderating one's desire to get rich quickly by whatever means or greatly at whatever cost to self or others. Now, we recall our Lord in speaking about the dangers of wealth, said how difficult it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, for it is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter heaven. I was explaining this to seminarians about how some commentators are of the opinion that there actually was a gate in Jerusalem called the Eye of the Needle, because it was so low that for camels to get in, they had to unload all the provisions, have the camel get down on its knees, and then the person had to pull the camel crawling on its knees through the gate. Now, whether that was really true, I don't know for sure, but it could be an explanation, or our Lord could have been speaking in a symbolic language just to get across the point that people who have a lot of wealth or see it become preoccupied with procuring wealth and keeping the wealth and managing, etc., and then it can cloud one's spiritual vision and one's concern about the things that really matter, the salvation of souls. And you know that one of the avarice or covetousness has different, we use different words like greed, but there's one word that's used, miserliness. And a miser is one who loves money for his own sake. He might live in very poor circumstances because he's afraid of spending his money. He just is so attached to the money itself that he doesn't even want to spend it for his own, sometimes, needs. And there's an interesting picture. I've always been struck by this picture in the wonderful book, The Imitation of Christ. And of course, there are different editions of this. This is the one that we have at Mary Magdalene Queen Center that is put out by the Confraternity of the Precious Blood. But anyway, there are all these pictures. And this one picture on chapter 44 in the third book, which is a very short section entitled Exterior Things, shows a man is counting his money. And in one hand he has coins in his hand, he's counting them, the other hand is writing the book, you know, counting up how much he has. And the devil is standing over him with a big smile of glee on his face, like he has this man. And then you see at the other end of the room, the office door, and it has a pane of glass in the door. And you can read the words, no admittance, that are on the door. And on the other side of the door is our Lord knocking. And so someone who is so attached to money basically is saying to our Lord, you're not welcome in my life, in my heart, in my affairs, because they have chosen the world. So not all of this in this meditation pertains to covetousness, but it's a great meditation and it's short, so I will read that. My son, the voice of Christ, my son, in many things it behooves you to be ignorant and to esteem yourself as one dead upon earth, as one to whom the whole world is crucified. Many things also must you pass by with a deaf ear and think rather of those things that pertain to your peace. It is more profitable to turn away your eyes from such things as displease you, and to leave to everyone his own way of thinking, than to give way to contentious discourses. If you stand well with God, and look at his judgment, you will more easily bear to see yourself overcome than the voice of the disciple. O Lord, to what are we come? Behold, a temporal loss is greatly bewailed. For a small gain, men labor and toil, but the loss of the soul is little thought of, and hardly returns to mind. That which is of little or no profit takes up our thoughts, and that which is above all things necessary is negligibly passed over. For the whole man sinks down into outward things, and unless he quickly recovers himself, he willingly continues immersed in them. So I just think it's a very valuable meditation. So let us reflect then upon where in our lives this vice, this capital sin of covetousness, may be raising its head. Because let's remember the seven capital sins, we have an inclination to all of them. And there are ways by which maybe we are affected by this capital sin that we don't even recognize. You know, I was thinking of this story about Saint Gabriel of Our Lady of Sorrows, whose feast is next Tuesday. And he was a passionist religious in the 1800s. And in his monastery, everything was in common, so that the habits that the religious wore, they didn't have their own habit that they wore. They put things in the laundry room, then they would come out, there were names on them, and they would be put in a common wardrobe and they would be in different sizes of tall and medium and short, etc. So whenever he would go to get another habit, he would always look through the ones his size and choose the one that was in the worst wear, the most threadbare, patched, torn, or whatever. And if it was a little torn, he would sew it and would always try and return it in better condition than when he got it. But think about our natural tendency is always to get the best. We want the best for ourselves. So here's a saint and how he overcame that. This is one more thought, a little off the subject, but on the idea of covetousness, is I don't know if any of you are familiar with the writings of Father Dennis Fahey. Now, Father Dennis Fahey was an Irish priest around the 1930s, and he wrote a book called The Mystical Body of Christ in the Modern World, as well as some others. But one of the interesting things he points out, because we Americans tend to think that capitalism is the best system economically. And he points out that it's the opposite extreme of communism or socialism. So socialism denies private property. But he says the answer, or not, the solution is not what he calls laissez-faire capitalism, which means capitalism taken to an extreme, in which people, individuals, are just numbers. You know, someone who has a business, what's his whole concern? How much money do I make? This is can be the tendency of capitalism. Instead of a concern for his workers, and they have families, and they have needs, etc. And so someone who is truly appreciated by employees and is a truly good employer is one who has a genuine concern for those who work for him. Whereas oftentimes it happens with companies in this country, people get fired, they get laid off, because there's no concern for them individually. It's just what's the bottom line and how am I going to make the most money. So it's interesting if you're ever interested in that topic, because we tend to think, as Americans, the way we're raised, that capitalism is the best system economically. And you know that G.K. Chesterton, a very brilliant man and a devout Catholic, promoted an economic system that he called distributism. It wasn't the excesses of, obviously, socialism to one extreme or laissez-faire capitalism to the other extreme. So we may have a more difficult time. We certainly do have a more difficult time than, say, someone who was raised in a Catholic country, maybe the Middle Ages, etc., with this vice, this capital sin of covetousness. Because everything that our American culture preaches up to us is to get as much as you can, you know, as much wealth as you can, and that's necessary for happiness. But of course, we know very well that wealth does not bring happiness. things, and that the good life is one that is primarily virtuous, but also insofar as material things, acquiring a sufficiency for our needs, and trying to be very careful we don't become preoccupied with material things or wealth, lest we lose the peace of soul that is a beautiful sign of being in heaven with God one day. So covetousness, our second of the capital sins,